South Bank Show, in association with the Sunday Telegraph. The art of a perfect Sunday.
Tonight on the South Bank Show, a fairy tale in the world of dance. The remaking of Cinderella by Matthew Bourne's Adventures in Motion Pictures. Years ago, a small contemporary dance company called Adventures in Motion Pictures stunned the dance world by staging their reinterpretation of Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake at the Piccadilly Theatre in London. It was the most successful West End run of a ballet since Diaghilev in the 1920s. While Matthew Bourne's choreography and direction were praised by press and public alike, some of the more traditional dance critics ascribed the success of the show to the shock value of casting men in the role of swans and criticised Bourne's lack of classical training. The big question was, could he do it again? I spoke to the choreographer about his upbringing in East London and the influence of films and Hollywood musicals on his work. Leo Burley's film followed Matthew Bourne and company as they prepared for their next West End show, a version of Prokofiev's Cinderella, set during the London Blitz of the Second World War.
The best reason for doing one of these pieces is to love the music. The first thing I do is to listen to it all the time, for months. That way I start to build up in my mind a plot. It develops in the same way a film plot would develop. It's a narrative, it's a story. It becomes dancing as soon as we get into the studio, but it could become anything.
Why did you want to set it so emphatically in the Blitz in London?
When I heard it was actually written during the war, I thought, well, it all sort of tied together for me, because I felt that I could use all my interest in film to put into the plot, and the period seemed to work for me for the story of Cinderella, with the idea of somebody going missing, that the idea of escapism during the war, of going to the ball, all that kind of feeling I felt I could do something with. I do feel as though it's part of my personal history. My parents were there, my grandparents.
My father was what they used to call an air raid warden, you know. He used to walk around the streets when the air raids were on and we would be in the shelter. So I've conveyed all that to Matthew. You're going to see some of it in Cinderella, I'm sure of that.
To see a dance company all sitting in a cinema watching a documentary about the Blitz probably seems odd, but it really does work well for us because it feeds them information in a way that really gives a seriousness to what we're doing. It would be good to just introduce you to some of the characters from the family. So, we've got Cinderella first.
Bit of a frump. We first see stepmother when she's coming down in the morning in just a kimono. When we move into Daywear, she turns into a bit of a Joan Crawford. Again, we've gone back to tones of black, white, greys and things.
And the pilot is our prince, basically. We have no royal aspect in this show. And the prince becomes this sort of war hero, David Niven type figure. Now he's brought in by our fairy godmother substitute, which is a guardian angel, somewhat like Wings of Desire.
The basic set is completely blue. It's bombed out London. It's London 1945. Blitz? Five?
No, one.
41. Close. And that's going to be our basic set for the whole evening. With each scene, as you'll see, the box adapts to be what we want it to be.
the dances are less kind of clear-cut as they would be in Swan Lake, for example. It's not got that easy structure that we've worked with before. The music is quite filmic, which gives it a nice atmosphere, and you'll see more of what we've done with that as we go along.
Are you receiving me? Repeat, are you receiving me? Request your position. Come in, Lancaster.
You seem like a nice girl. I can't give you my position. Instruments gone, crew gone too. All except Bob here, my Sparks. He's dead. The rest all bailed out on my orders. Time 0335. You get that?
My love of cinema affects everything that I do, really. I often call upon it for images and ideas and characters.
When will I report?
Our pilot hero is very much like David Niven. Any wartime film seems to have images that will help us with this piece.
After researching the Blitz period, the company assembles at the Drama Centre in North London. Bourne has already devised the initial choreography with his principal dancers. They now develop their steps with the rest of the cast.
We're committed to 8 shows a week, which is a lot of shows for any dance company to do. So right from the beginning with this, we're starting with 3 casts.
Okay, so what we're going to do today is look at this duet, which is the dummy duet.
It's quite difficult in rehearsal, but it will work for us in the end because we'll never have to cancel a show.
Bit of a solo, which I don't...
We're going to start work on a duet for Cinderella and the pilot, who is their prince figure in the piece. Having met this pilot earlier in the act, she imagines that this dummy is him. So she dances with it as she would a man.
Eventually it goes off up here.
Through the magic of theatre, we change the dummy into the real Adam Cooper.
And then it's replaced by whoever.
What we're trying to achieve is movement which looks like Cinderella is initiating everything, which is difficult, especially when you're lifting. Everybody who's in the studio contributes a lot. They come up with material and ideas for plot and for movement, which Matthew then either accepts or declines to use.
That's what you're doing with the other leg at the moment, but that's the same.
The emphasis is very different. Oh, yeah. If I've got something to look at, then I can start to mould it into more what I want. But I can't just start a rehearsal by saying, okay, you know, do 2 turns and extend your leg and things like that. I just don't do that. I can't think that way.
Let's play it with the music and you'll see where it is. I think I'm not sure exactly what count that's on. And 1, 2, 3, 4.
Sarah, who's come into the company just to do this project, is known to be the young thing at the Royal Ballet that everyone so admires. She's not here because we've grabbed her. She's a great actress. She's unusual. She's different from all the other ballerinas at the Royal.
Everybody else is going to do Cinderella will do it in their own way. I think it's going to be a very individual character. I know I'm much more classical than most of the dancers in this company, so I don't quite know how I'm going to feel being involved with everybody. It's quite daunting. Hopefully they'll all accept me okay.
Take a couple of steps back and you let go and she has to hang on.
And then you give it legs like, oh, go on.
Oh, go on.
Sarah Wildor and Adam Cooper, partners in real life, are set to dance the roles of Cinderella and Pilot on the first night. Wilder is only on loan from the Royal Ballet, but Cooper, who played the lead in Swan Lake, has since quit the Royal to work with Bourne full-time.
The only other time I've ever danced with Sarah was in a piece for the Royal Ballet called The Invitation. In the studio, we get on pretty well, but especially on stage, I think there's definitely a big chemistry and a big spark that will happen.
Principals in this some of them are very strongly classically trained dancers.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you want to employ them, and what are they bringing to it, do you think?
I was known for humour for a long time for the work I did. It was always, we were known as the funny company. And having done Swan Lake, I think I enjoy the other side of the work now is moving people as well. I particularly welcome with Adam what he's given me. Artists of his calibre have brought that sincerity to the work.
What drew you to Swan Lake? Why did you want to do that?
For contemporary choreographers, it's their favourite ballet because it's got a kind of the swan scenes have got this kind of abstract edge to them, and it allows you to be inventive with movement because they're creatures, they're not princesses and things. I suppose that's what kind of inspired me to have men as swans and to see if I could make that work. But as I
why was that then, to develop that? Because that was one of the features, the male dancers as swans.
I think I could always see it with men. I think I felt that it would have such a more powerful impact, which I feel is in the music. I feel that the music is much more powerful than it ever comes across in the classical ballet. The entrance of the swans is the same groupings as the ballet, but different steps. So I used that structure to get me going, basically. It was the first bit we did. With men, I could show the two sides of the swans, both the lyrical side and the more violent side, the strength of a swan.
How far were you satirising the traditional choreography of Swan Lake there in certain parts of your production?
Well, I don't think I was at all, actually. I approached it completely seriously. I wasn't attempting to do any kind of parody or send-up. There's only one thing where I refer to it. We've got four signets, but we've done something completely different with them.
Watching his four male signets, but that's still the light, childish side of Matthew. It's as you can watch the chief swan and the prince, and then what happens in the last half of the ballet that you're really moving into adult emotion.
Because of the male dancers and so on, this became tagged as a homoerotic gay ballet. Did that mm-hmm. bother you?
Although it was dubbed that in many areas, it didn't seem to stop people from coming, because I think what we'd very carefully done with it was to try and weave people's own stories into it, so that when you watch it, there was nothing completely blatant in it or a point in it where you go, oh, well, that's what it's about. The height of their kind of sexual relationship is really just him wrapping him in his wings, and it's a sort of a caring thing more than a sexual thing in many ways.
Homoerotic relationships in your work have been steadily worked through, haven't they? Is that a useful,
no,
is that an accurate observation?
Well, it's partly because I'm gay myself, and I, you know, that's part of my life, and so I put it into the work. And it's also partly because I try and show in the pieces a bit of the real world.
Matthew Bourne was born in Walthamstow, East London, in 1960. His parents had no show business connections, but encouraged him in their own passion for West End and Hollywood musicals.
We used to watch a lot of Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland and the magic of Fred Astaire. Well, he's up there, isn't he, a lot? Matthew was, you know, his mind was working, you know?
Yeah, it was.
Yes, let's do that. Yeah. Yes.
What were the first shows you remember seeing as a child?
The very first thing I saw, I think, was The Sound of Music on my fifth birthday. I was taken to the Dominion, Tottenham Court Road, looking up at Julie Andrews coming over that hill. I honestly feel I've never been the same since, you know. I think my parents were very influential in sort of forming my taste by actually sitting me down to watch things that they liked.
I was building stages in his bedroom for him to perform on. The neighbours used to come in, the old ladies up the road, you know.
Tea and biscuits.
Yeah, tea and biscuits
show.
And a show.
Yes.
I did do a production of Cinderella at school with all the men playing women and all the women playing men. And I think I was about 7 or 8 when I did that. My brother was actually Cinderella and I was an ugly sister.
He did shows at school, and then he went on at 11. He formed his own little group called the Bournadium Theatre Group.
There was an obvious obsession there, but I don't think we knew as a family how to direct it or where to go. And I was extremely naive about the whole thing.
The obsession spilled out in all sorts of directions. As I understand it, around that time you became a fanatical autograph hunter and letter writer, and a very successful one.
I suppose I was about 13, 14, 15, that sort of age when I did it very, very regularly. That's really what got me through school in a way. I hated school. I used to get the 38 bus from Walthamstow with my best friend Simon virtually every day to go to a first night. It was like the mid-70s, and a lot of the sort of legendary stars were still alive then. Charlie Chaplin, we're proud of that at the time. Ginger Rogers, difficult cow she was. There's a picture of me when I was 16 with John Paul Belmondo. This one's quite interesting because it's Henry Fonda, and this is me here with Henry Fonda. But it's actually at the Piccadilly Theatre where we play Swan Lake and Cinderella at the moment.
We're now calling the blackout, takes Cinderella on a journey through the streets of London, and she's following her guardian angel. What we were doing this afternoon is the sort of culmination of that. It's the end of Act One. It's basically the scene where she leaves for the ball. This music is particularly difficult to count, and I create my own counts, which is, it's not how a musician would count, it's how I hear a phrase of music or a melody line or something. So I count a certain amount of counts for that melody line or that change in the music. I kind of divide it up in that way.
And a one and a two and a three.
Some people really hang on to the counts, and there's other people who just literally remember through some sort of body memory.
And a run through the middle and a dun dun dun. Good, into the bike, round you go.
How did you manoeuvre yourself towards some sort of formal dance education? How did that come about?
I worked for a while.
After you left school?
Yeah, in a very naive way, trying to get into the business as such. Didn't have a clue what I was good at. I worked at the BBC. Was my first job. I thought, well, that's how I'm going to get into show business or something. And so I got this job filing at the BBC. But I also carried on my kind of autograph collecting thing there and meeting people. And the Pete Murray show used to have good guests.
Good morning to you, this is Pete Murray.
In my lunch hour, I used to pretend that I'd been sent to show them to the studio.
Were you still putting shows on and that sort of thing?
Yeah. It's sort of song and dance shows, basically, and sketches and things, sort of variety shows, I suppose. And a lot of them culled from things that I, by that point, had on video.
Before he went to college, he'd always do something out of an early musical that nobody else knew anything about. He thought they were the best thing that he'd ever seen. He was born too late, so he needed to... He should have been born in the 20s or 30s or something like that.
Yes.
And then you got into the Leiden Centre. How did you get there and what did you learn there?
I was 21, 22 by this point. Because I hadn't been to college, I hadn't done a degree of any kind. I justified it to myself in that it was an academic course, and that there was no possibility of me having a career in it. But I was so interested in it that I thought it would be time well spent, and I would get something out of it. So I applied to do this dance theatre degree course at the Laban Centre.
I first met Matthew 15 years ago, and I was teaching him dance history while he was in his second year. And all the students showed works of theirs. I was the member of staff who went up and said, you're the one.
I wanted to perform. Those of us on this course got together to form a company of our own. And that's how Adventures in Motion Pictures started, directly from college.
In 1988, Matthew Bourne presented Spitfire, the first of many shows to draw on the traditions of classical dance.
I'd always found those catalogues of mail order sort of catalogues, the pictures of the men in underwear, very funny, where they're all sort of chummy and sort of standing with each other in their underwear, so ridiculous, all looking like they're in a pub or something. And so I tied that idea with doing a romantic ballet. It struck a chord and helped us enormously. This little piece, it was only 11 minutes long. That was the start of us being known and noticed and getting somewhere.
The company as such was just a group of students at that time. I don't think there's been any sort of thought to the future at all. People tend not to believe us when we say this, but we survived on funds that were raised by Matt's mum and dad from car boot sales.
The idea of taking English customs, particularly English customs and English manners, we've got it in Town and Country as well, and we have it in Spitfire. That's something that appeals to you quite a lot, doesn't it?
Everyone's got this idea of England, and I was trying to show this England that everyone thinks existed but probably never did. You know, it's that sort of idealised view of England. Mm. What I was doing was a sort of a satire, and there wasn't very... much of that about in dance at the time. And I think that's one of the things that got us noticed early on was humour.
Years ago, you reinterpreted The Nutcracker for a modern audience. What attracted you to it, and how did you set about the reinterpretation?
The thing I found about it that I enjoyed most was working with a complete score. Before that, I'd done pieces that were like almost collage-y pieces, a bit of my favourite pieces of music put together. To have this structure to work with, and not to be tied down to the classical technique, and to have to do the choreography, because we're not a ballet company, was actually very liberating. We decided to set it in an orphanage and have all the dancers playing kids. It's got no enormous depth to it. It's just quite a lot of fun.
after the Nutcracker, we got a bit of a taste for it. So then we worked on a much smaller project, which was for seven dancers and based on a very old romantic ballet called La Sylphide, which we kind of updated to Glasgow in the 1990s. So it's kind of Trainspotting the ballet.
Why is he continually trying to redo the classics? He is achieving success by climbing onto somebody else's coattails. He hasn't achieved success because he's thought of something exciting and new and different. He's thought of something new and different and exciting about a classic that already exists.
Did you begin to worry that you were in a territory which other people felt was theirs, and that by taking these classical pieces you were in danger of being scorched?
I did worry about it initially, I think. I suppose I did. I don't now, because I feel we're doing something completely different and a viable alternative. I don't think we're trying to replace the classical versions in any way.
Often when the classical ballet is produced in its full version, whether it's Swan Lake or La Sylphide, character somehow seems to get left out. And Matt's approach is much more honest than that. It kind of cuts away all the things you have to know about ballet before you find it good or interesting, and consequently comes up with a product which is very kind of approachable. It doesn't necessarily depend on you knowing much about technique.
Classical ballet, it's like the dancing master turns up at the house to give the sisters tuition in the latest dances. We've come up with this idea where there's a gramophone in the room. Mother puts on a ballroom style record, so she sort of leads them in a dance. I just like playing with different characters and their kind of interaction between each other. So I made the family bigger, so it's not normally brothers, it's just sisters and a stepmother.
And three and four and a one, two and a three and four.
What we try and do is use social dancing quite a lot, i.e. forms of ballroom dancing, forms of jive and any of those period dances, but then you try and give it your own twist.
One, two, three, four, ten, five, six and seven.
Scott and Etta have worked with me for a long time now, and they're really essential to the creation of the whole thing. We find it easier to develop material like on our own in the evenings.
Our contributions end up in the finished product, so it feels like it's part of a company show rather than just the choreographer's vision. Although the end result is very much what Matthew wants, he expects us to contribute towards that process.
From there, you do one of those. One, two, three, turn, four, out, five, six, seven, and eight.
I missed about 5 days last week due to gastroenteritis, which was
not a very nice thing. And I suppose it was sort of on the cards a bit. It was probably overworking a bit. We are a bit behind now. And so I think we're in a position where we're probably cancelling a couple of previews to get the show finished. It's going to be tough the next 3 weeks, very tough.
Was it a big pressure going straight into the West End and being expected to produce a commercial hit in an area which has had only, well, perhaps in this level, only one commercial hit before, and that was your own? So did you feel that as a pressure, a responsibility?
Yeah, Swan Lake went into the West End having had reviews, which we could sell it on, and already had a certain amount of reputation and people were talking about it, whereas Cinderella hasn't. So it's been much more of a gamble.
Since the success of Swan Lake, it seemed that it would be more appropriate, instead of taking a step back from the commercial reality and the commercial world, to actually go forward with that. And our first sort of test was the season in Los Angeles.
Everyone was a little nervous because the show had very little reputation in America, but it immediately took off, and the reviews were sensational, and the audience just was screaming. I mean, even more vociferous than they were in London.
I thought it'd be good to keep a sort of visitor's book, so I was expecting a lot of, you know, Hollywood to come back, which they did. Wow, Kirk Douglas. Yeah. Annette Bening and Warren Beatty. I've got his home phone numbers, both of them. Angie Dickinson, Sally Field, Tony Basil, do you remember her? She's Bette Midler's choreographer now. You Are Too Good for This Town, Terry Gilliam. Richard Gere, loved it. You're All Fabulous, underlined three times.
The production was practically sold out for an 8-week season. And we're now looking at the possibility of co-producing it with Cameron McIntosh in New York and Broadway.
It's very rare that a choreographer of this brilliance comes up in any generation. I mean, you have to go back to the wit of Frederick Ashton to find a choreographer who can choreograph with such panache as Matthew.
Matthew's way of working is very typical of most English choreographers I've worked with. It's not dissimilar to Sir Frederick Ashton or Kenneth Macmillan, but I do think he's far more detailed. I'm playing the terrifically horrible stepmother in this particular scene, dancing with the object of Cinderella's desire. What we've used is really the idea that it's a ballroom dance with a mazurka rhythm.
We've got to make it feel like you're pulling him into it, haven't we, really? I mean, it'll come out of this little scene beforehand, but...
Lynn was known as, you know, the great dramatic ballerina of her time.
It feels like...
She still has all that, and that's what this company's about completely. It's about people acting and dancing.
Because you start there, do you? Come through here. Is there a way you could initiate it? That's it.
Anyone who's been dancing that many years is very easy to choreograph on because she's full of movement.
A reference to Sir Frederick Ashton's choreography in it, which is some
our movements that we've done. It's a sort of homage.
Ashton always influences me. I love the variety of his work, and he's such a genius at combining humour and romance. I think he's the most varied choreographer. That's what I like to do within one evening as well, is to try and vary the styles of choreography and the emotions as well, to make it as rich as his work.
I saw Matthew Bourne greedily taking in everything that the Royal Ballet had done with Cinderella, and of course this is Ashton, and Ashton at his best. And I had a sort of alarm bell started ringing all over my system. Oh God, he's going to do this next, I thought.
He's not trying to replace the ballets. He's trying to retell the stories. The stories weren't ballets when they were created. They were fables, they were tales, they were fairy tales. They weren't ballets.
I think the composers, like Prokofiev and Tchaikovsky, would be the first ones to be actually working side by side, saying, can't we put a synthesizer in here or whatever, because they would love to see their work be fresh and have a terrific reaction with a modern audience.
I think my father would have accepted this production because it has modernity and has links with tradition, especially that it's not just pure drama. I think it implies a certain humor in it. And to this sides of art and life, he was very sensitive.
There's another one where you're like there, where you've just got both arms out, a helper. Which one's that? Where does that come from?
With only 2 weeks until Cinderella begins to preview, Matthew must add the finishing touches to the show.
I feel like a great position. Could it stay something nearer to where you were?
Yeah.
You know, so you just... Yeah, where does it go from there? Because you could come out of it if you're from here, aren't you? If you opened it, you could come out of it like that.
Okay.
And
that
might be better.
It's hard to see any other steps done to that music in a way because I've done it for quite a few years now.
Keeping still quite tight there.
Matthew suggested certain things that he wanted at certain points in the music, and that was the only time I've ever listened to the music in a different way.
It might be good if, because he's been looking at you all that time, if we could get something in there where you're looking another way, so you do this to him somewhere, or bring his head back to look at you, you know?
Yes.
Earlier on? Yeah.
No, in that last, because you haven't been looking, but then you have been looking, and then he doesn't again, I wonder if we could build that in anywhere.
Maybe on the next bit.
Yeah.
There's a great deal of acting without words, but it isn't quite miming. Mm. So what's going on there?
I think we've developed our own sort of way of telling a story, which is to do with acting facially, obviously, and bodily. I think it works eventually, because a lot of people say to me that it gets to a point in the evening where they suddenly realise no one's said anything. The fact that they feel comfortable with it is great, because that's what we're trying to do.
Matthew is always primarily involved in characterization and story, and that often, to my mind, makes him an oddly unclassical, even anti-classical dance maker.
He's got a very vivid sense of what works in the theatre, just as Nureyev had. but he hasn't got the range of movement, the knowledge of technical classical steps.
Ballet has a language, a mime language, that nobody really understands. Nobody, unless you're educated in classical vocabulary, etc. You don't really know what this mime language means. I've set the challenge to myself of not having a synopsis in the programme. I don't believe in them. I think you should tell the story, and you shouldn't need to know anything before the curtain goes up. You have to tell your story.
That's terrible.
As with most West End productions, Cinderella enjoys 2 weeks of public preview performances before the critics are allowed in. An all-important chance to gauge audience reaction before a review is written.
She comes through.
At the moment we're previewing, and so everything's here, it's just literally a matter of working on the queuing of the pieces and making it better and making it tighter and making it work.
Okay.
So hopefully by Tuesday it'll be finished and no one will have to keep rehearsing, because they've been rehearsing all day, they've been performing in the evening, it's just getting a bit tiring now.
Sarah Wilder, who plays Cinderella, she's hurt her neck, and so she doesn't know she's going to perform tonight, and Sarah, the other Cinderella, has pulled her intercostal muscles or something.
Yeah, ribs, so. And Maxine isn't completely rehearsed in the role, so it'll be a bit sort of last minute for her to go on it. You can't, well.
Yeah, we're not sure what's going to happen yet. I think Sarah's gone to physio and is going to see how she is when she gets back.
Sarah Wilder's injury is bad enough to stop her performing. Matthew is forced to cancel the preview. He declined to be interviewed and broke the bad news to the company. Opening night is 4 days away.
Sarah should be able to go on tomorrow, being Friday. And then we've got Saturday, and then Monday we've got more rehearsals, and then Tuesday's the first night. So hopefully by then Sarah will be up and running, and we'll have a full cast without any injuries, because at the moment we've hit quite a big injury scare. There are a lot of people who are very tired.
During that preview time, it's such a pressure. And leading up towards the first night of Cinderella, you realise that there was a lot of expectation. Suddenly, I began to feel it more.
Would someone from
there's still things that I would have liked to have done that there wasn't enough time to do, and you have to freeze the show at some point and get everyone feeling confident about what they're doing, making sure they feel that it's a good show and that they're happy to do it. And there are things in the back of my mind I think, well, I'd love to do that, but actually it's a bit too big a change to do at this point. So there are things I will do, definitely.
He's given you a complete piece of theatre, that the way you watch certain plays or operas, and he's done it without words. And there's very few bits that you go to as pure dance. I think this is something fairly new, at least in British theatre.
You've said two or three times that you approach it as if it were a ballet, as if it were a play, as if it were a film. do you think because of this three-pronged attack you're getting a new sort of audience turning up?
Yes, I think so. The surprise is that people who have never liked dance before can actually relax and enjoy it and follow it. And it's a very simplistic sort of thing to say, but I think it's true. Of a lot of dance, people are expected to have a lot of prior knowledge. So I think it is appealing to a wider audience and a younger audience as well.
The triumph of being able to commercially run a ballet in the West End is fantastic. It does not mean that that can happen for lots of other people, because there aren't lots of other Matthew Bournes.
I don't think that a lot of the arts establishment understand the risk that the company takes in producing this sort of work. If we have two or three bad weeks, we're off.
Found a successful formula. He takes the classical ballet and then he puts it in a modern setting, he gives it fresh ideas, modern slant and so on, and theatrically this is very effective. But what happens when he runs out of classical ballets?
Cinderella works. It works the way Miss Saigon works. It works the way Madame Butterfly works. He has made it into a West End musical of tremendous charm.
I would love to see this show 2 months down the road, and I think it'll be fabulous. It's a great show already, heaven's sake, but it'll be great.
Opera and ballet have so often been in the province of people, you know, who can spend 100 quid for a ticket. And I think the most expensive seat in the Piccadilly is 25 quid.
I expected more humour. I mean, Ashton got far more humour out of Prokofiev than Bourne has done. But on the whole, this is a very enjoyable performance, and certainly a new one, and an exciting updating of a story. Well worth seeing.
Are you surprised, looking round, as to how far you've come, how quickly, after, as it were, a long, slow start?
Yeah, very surprised. It's like it is a bit of a fairy story in some ways. It's a bit naff to say, but I kind of feel that I'm doing what I always dreamt of doing, really, now. I mean, when I went to Hollywood, I was meeting all these legends that I loved as a kid and things.
They were asking for your autograph.
They were, actually. I still don't quite believe it. I feel someone's going to find me out very soon.
Well, I hope not, and I'm sure not. Thanks very much.
Thanks.
South Bank Show, in association with the Sunday Telegraph, the art of a perfect Sunday.